Tonight, we begin a week-long series on Africa's most populous country, Nigeria, Pain and Promise. Special correspondent Nick Schifrin and producer and cameraman Zack Fannin spent more than a month on the ground there, chronicling a nation in the midst of an encouraging and impressive economic boom, but still plagued by income inequality, corruption, and terrorism. This evening, we look at the government's attempts to wipe out Boko Haram, a terrorist group that killed more people in 2014 than the Islamic State we hear so much about. While the Nigerian military has made significant gains, the killings by the group continue. As we report, some civilians are getting caught in the middle. A warning, some of the images in this report may be disturbing.
On the outskirts of Maiduguri, the men who protect the city fight with whatever they could find. 40-year-old shotguns and iPhone earbuds. Some carve their own clubs. Others patrol in floral and kitchen knives. What they lack in weaponry, they make up for in divinely inspired confidence.
There's a couple of shotguns, there's a few machetes, a few knives,
yes.
But that's it. I mean, what would you actually be able to do if you ran into Boko Haram out here?
We chase them out of Maiduguri with stick and we don't have gun. And when they have AK-47, they have RPG on their hand. But we push them out. God has put in the fear of civilian jet on their heart.
51-year-old Abba Aji Jaku leads the civilian JTF for Joint Task Force. He used to be a government auditor. Today, he's more comfortable on the front lines.
If we kept walking this way, where would we end up?
If we keep walking here, we'll end up in Zambeza.
In Zambeza Forest, their headquarters.
In the Boko Haram headquarters.
Down this road.
Down this road.
His men call him Elder. That's him in dark gray on the left. He and his vigilantes round up suspects using their own brand of justice. Their biggest fear, boys and girls carrying bombs.
They are using female to come and detonate their bomb attack on us. So if we see anybody, we will not take chances.
Those bomb attacks are Boko Haram's primary weapon. An intelligence official says the group's detonated more bombs in the last 6 months than the previous 6 years.
So many of Boko Haram's targets today are soft, like this mosque. A man walked in here pretty much to where I'm standing and blew himself up as a group prayed. The explosion was so powerful, it obliterated the mosque's roof. More than three-quarters of the victims are Muslim, and these attacks are grisly. A few days after this one, and you can still smell the blood that stains the walls.
Boko Haram celebrates its attacks in slick, ISIL-inspired propaganda. It pledged allegiance to ISIL and now calls itself the Islamic State of West Africa. They embrace ISIL's brutality. Last year, the group captured Moubi and made the city its administrative capital. Its leader, Abu Bakr Shekau, preached from a local mosque, and his fighters celebrated in newly acquired Nigerian army tanks.
Very, very dangerous for everyone, because if you can see the attack, they have attacked mosques, they have attacked church, they have attacked Christians, they have attacked Muslims. They are very dangerous.
Yao Said could be the most courageous man in Moubi. When Boko Haram arrived, he filmed this video, riding his motorcycle into the stronghold to rescue his mother.
I called my mom and she said they're hearing the sound of gunshot, everywhere gunshot.
He witnessed an exodus, a city of 140,000 people fleeing by any means necessary. In total, more than 2 million people have fled Boko Haram since the fighting began.
What did Nigerian army soldiers do when Boko Haram attacked?
They do nothing. Nigerian army, they not do nothing when they attack Moubi. And there is nobody, no any single person have shot one single bullet.
But today, the Nigerian military is firing back. It released this video showing Boko Haram fighters fleeing an Air Force attack. The military success has redrawn the map. At its peak, Boko Haram controlled an area the size of Belgium. Now, it controls only three remote towns and a final stronghold, the Sambisa Forest.
We are doing what we are doing.
Military spokesman Colonel Rabi Abubakar says this year the military has been transformed.
There has been tremendous change between what it used to be to now. Morale of the troops, equipment, leadership, there will never be any territory that will fall back to Boko Haram insurgency never again.
Mubi might be recaptured, but the reconstruction has barely begun. Bridges bombed by Boko Haram are still broken. Street vendors use burned-out cars as fruit stands. Many banks are still destroyed and empty. Boko Haram looted the cash to finance itself. Inside, that red frame is all that's left of the front door. Those papers, all that's left of depositors' accounts. Outside the nearby Church of the Brethren, the damage is everywhere. Inside, high above the podium, the fire set by Boko Haram almost erased the cross from the wall. 16 parishioners died. Ilya Usman is the church's secretary.
When these people landed in Mubi, they will ask you, are you a Christian or a Muslim? When you say you're a Christian, they will shoot you. There's no one single church left in Mubi. They burnt it.
But the streets are busy. And those who fled have returned, including Yahu's mother, Haria Muhammad.
Why do you feel safe here?
We want everybody to go back to his or her village. We'll provide all the arsenals at our disposal.
Borno Governor Kashim Shettima leads the state at the epicenter of this war. He vows to force all internally displaced people, or IDPs, to return home by May.
The population of Maiduguri has snowballed, and it's a cake powder waiting to explode. So I think it's in our enlightened self-interest to expedite action in rebuilding the homes. Once they are back to their communities, at least their kids can go to school. Now we are really bringing up a whole generation of ignoramuses, of idiots, you know, of illiterates. All our schools are closed. All our schools have been converted into IDP camp.
There is nowhere in the world with more children out of school. The IDP camps are overflowing with people and trauma. Hadisa is 17 years old. She was kidnapped by Boko Haram and held for nearly a year. In this war, the spoils of the battlefield are often girls. Hadisa uses the word marriage only out of shame.
This really isn't marriage, is it?
No, it's rape.
Garita Birukila is a UNICEF public health specialist based in Maiduguri.
Some girls were raped by different men. So we know that in any religion or any culture, that is not marriage.
But for Hadisa and hundreds of other girls, the impact is permanent. She's 6 months pregnant.
And what will you tell your child about his or her father? How traumatized are some of these girls?
We have children who arrived and they lost their voice because of what they saw. They saw the killings of their parents. They walked over dead bodies. Although now they are safe, it seems that the war still rages in their mind.
Boko Haram also kidnapped this boy. He's scared they will kill his family if he reveals his identity. I asked him his age. He didn't know. Boko Haram teachers tried to indoctrinate him. Had they succeeded, he would have ended up a suicide bomber, or like this teenager in a Boko Haram propaganda video.
Were you convinced by what you learned from Boko Haram's teachers?
When he escaped, the military found him and accused him of being a militant. He says they left these marks on his arms.
All of them, they are Boko Haram members.
The military has been accused of human rights abuses and indiscriminate arrests. This video is from 2013. All the people rounded up by soldiers were thrown into the most notorious facility in the area, the Army's Giwa Barracks.
What is it like inside of Kiwa Barracks?
This woman insists she is not Boko Haram. She spent 1 year inside Giwa Barracks and was never charged with anything. The army spokesman didn't deny her allegations of abuse.
It could be that, yes, there are some, could be some isolated cases, but this has been in this dispensation, in this present leadership, the emphasis is anybody, any uniformed man who manhandled a civilian anywhere, either in the war front or anywhere, please report and we'll take appropriate actions against that.
But it's not clear that's possible when the victims say they're threatened into silence.
Were you told never to talk to anyone about what happened to you in Giwa Barracks?
Eventually, Nigeria will win the battle against Boko Haram, but the years of torture, rape, and kidnapping leave open wounds. The larger war won't be won until those wounds are healed. Nick Schifrin, PBS NewsHour, Maiduguri, Nigeria.
And you can tune in tomorrow for Nick's next report on Nigeria, Pain and Promise, this one about the nation's status as the continent's biggest economy.